welcome to Environmental Dimensions. I'm Jennifer Fields, and today we're going to be talking about a landscaping technique known as integrated pest management. Joining me here today is Bill Reeves. Bill is the president of two corporations, Accents on Nature and EnviroLawn. Welcome, Bill. Thank you for coming today. And my other guest is Kevin Berger, who's the division director of the Pollution Prevention and Remediations Programs Division.
Very good.
With the Broward County Department of Natural Resource Protection. That's a mouthful.
Yeah. Thank you.
Bill, I'll start with you.
Okay.
What is integrated pest management?
Integrated pest management is the idea to try to incorporate alternatives to the chemicals that we've been using for years. Try to use biological pest control. Try to use mechanical control like trimming out infestations. Try to just look at all the different alternatives that exist to us other than the chemicals we've been using, both culturally and mechanically and other areas that are out there.
Is it important to use native plants and trees in our landscapes?
In my opinion, yes. It lowers the possibility for certain insect infestations. It increases wildlife activity, birds and butterflies and other animal life to come into the area, and definitely lowers our irrigation use in some cases, and lowers definitely our pesticide use.
Mm-hmm. Why do we have such a pest problem with our landscapes? I know I've got two or three plants in particular that seem to be constantly bothered by different pests.
In my opinion, two specific reasons, exotic species and monocultures. Monocultures, basically, we see them used a lot in agriculture. It's when they take one specific species and grow it over one large vast area, like corn or wheat.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing in horticulture. We take grass and grow it over large vast areas. That's also a monoculture. Or one specific hedge over one large area. That can also become a monoculture. And with all monocultures, you get insect infestation. Now, you have the opportunity to get a really bad insect infestation. And with exotic species, we tend to see that a lot of times the insect infestations that attack these exotic species, a lot of cases the insects that are attacking it are not native also. So you end up getting different problems that exist by not using the natives with the exotics. There's a lot of studies going on right now where all these insect pests come from and attack our exotic species.
Mm. Kevin, your department is involved in environmental protection. So I would imagine that you have some specific concerns related to pesticide use by not just homeowners, but I would imagine all of us here in South Florida who use pesticides.
That's correct, Jennifer. In fact, the state of Florida is ranked second in the nation in the consumptive use of pesticides. Only California stands in front of the state of Florida, so we have very particular concerns related to our drinking water supply, especially in Broward County and South Florida area, because we have a sole source drinking water aquifer called the Biscayne Aquifer.
Mm-hmm. What type of, I guess it would be called pollution prevention, initiatives or programs have you put into place in your agency for Broward County to control some of the use of pesticides?
Well, we have a number of different programs that don't necessarily relate to today's topic, but we have what's called our Earthkeeper Volunteer Program, which is where we educate the general public on the types of environmental violations that they might see in their day-to-day activities, and to bring those to their attention so that they could let us know if they see anything out there while they're out driving around or going to the store, whatever might be the case. If they let us know that, we can send our inspectors out to check those situations out. We also have what's called our Best Management Practices Program, and that's where we work with the regulated community to try to develop ways to help them operate their businesses in an environmentally sound manner.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of that then, is there any sort of best management practice for large users of pesticides, for instance, lawn maintenance services?
Well, we're working on looking at different industrial categories, including lawn maintenance type services, golf courses, nurseries, where there's a large quantity of pesticide usage, and looking at ways that we might be able to assist them and looking at alternatives to pesticides that they currently use in an attempt to reduce consumption.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing specifically with regard to pesticide usage in homeowners at your department?
Well, during the next couple months, we're planning on running a series of educational workshops and public outreach programs to help people better understand more sound, common sense pest management techniques that can be used both from a landscaping technique and from a maintenance standpoint.
Mm-hmm. Bill, a few days ago, we were out and about in Fort Lauderdale, and you and I and some others went to a yard where you showed us some of these best management practices that implemented. What were, how did you get involved in that project to begin with?
That specific project or overall? Well, the homeowner had contacted us, wanted to lower their dependency on chemicals. They also wanted to eliminate a lot of the maintenance, the physical maintenance of trimming and hedging and things of that nature. And that specific project that you saw was designed